Bang, Mr. True. In this video, we are going to expand our knowledge of variation problems, whether direct or inverse variation, and introduce some more complexity to the problem, because in real life, you know, things aren't always just a relationship between just two variables. There's a lot of times, especially in like physics problems and electrical problems, where there's just more related, there's more going on than just an x and a y. So joint variation is when y varies jointly as x and z if there is some non-zero constant k such that y equals k times x times z. So it's kind of like just an expanded form of your direct variation. It's just that there's more than two variables being directly related to each other. Now, this is kind of a special case of the more general idea of a combined variation. And now that's when one variable or quantity varies either directly and or, it can be a combination of two, direct and inverse variation, or inversely, as two or more other variables or quantities. You don't have to just have three quantities or variables in your equation other than a constant. That can be more complicated than that. Quantities that vary directly are going to be in the numerator. This is a sort of a footnote for the combined variation. Quantities that vary directly are in the numerator, and quantities that vary inversely are going to be found in the denominator. Because remember, direct variation is y equals kx, and inverse variation, when you have the equation set up for equal to y, is going to be y equals k over x. So direct variation, those variables are going to be found in the numerator, and the inverse variation, those variables are going to be found in the denominator. So let's get to our first example. We're going to do four in this video. I always do a lot of them. That's why they tend to be a little bit long. And this will be the first of four. Suppose y varies jointly as x and y. Find y when x equals 8 and z equals 3 if y equals 105 when x equals 5 and z is equal to 6. Even though our problems are getting a little bit more complex, they still have to give you enough information to find the constant of change. It's basically never given to you. So we're going to use that last little bit here where they give us y, x, and z to find out what k is. Now, if we don't have a basic structure of the equation, we're not going to be able to find anything. So as we start off the problem, it says y varies jointly. Okay, so y varies, so it's going to be y is equal to, and joint variation is y equals k times x times z, so it's basically a direct variation, but just with more than one other variable. So y equals k times x times, not y, but z. So we got the basic structure of our joint variation written down. As soon as I read this, I would stop and write this out. And now we're going to go to where the part of the problem where they give us all the information except for the constant. So when y equals 105, we don't know the constant of change, but we know that x equals 5 and z is equal to 6. Okay, so 5 times 6 is 30. So we have 105 equals k times 30, or you can write 30k. We need to undo that multiplication by dividing both sides by 30. Now, if you do it with your calculator, you're going to have your answer, but let's just do this a little bit in our head. 30, 60, 90, 120. Okay, well, 120 is bigger than 105. So 30, 60, 90. So there's three 30s in 105. Now, if we look at the 90, 105 minus 90 is 15, and 15 as a remainder over 30 is going to reduce to, 15 over 30 is going to reduce to 1/2. So this is 3 1/2, or I'm going to write that as an improper fraction because I don't ever like to work with mixed fractions unless I'm writing a final answer. So 2 times 3 is equal to 6 plus 1 is 7. So k is equal to 7 over 2, at least in the format that we're going to work with it through the rest of the problem. Now we're going to come up here, write the actual equation out. We have y equals 7 over 2, because that's k, times x times z. Okay, now let's go to the other part of the problem where they don't, you know, they ask us to find one of these three variables, x, y, or z. We've got the constant now, we've got the equation. The actual problem says find y when x is equal to 8 and z is equal to 3. So we're going to do y is equal to 7 over 2. X again is 8. Z is 3. 1/2 of 8 is equal to 4, because we have a division of 2 and a multiplication of 8. You know what? You might want to, when you work with fractions, because a lot of my students, or I see a lot of students that struggle with them, you know, if you have a problem that has one fraction in it, it might be helpful to just write every number as a fraction, so you can see those common denominators you might need, or you can see this cancellation opportunity that we have. 2 divided by 2 is 1, and 8 divided by 2 is 4. So we really just have, with the 8 divided by 2 is 4, we have 7 times 4, which is 28. And that times 3, well, 3 times 20 is 60, and 3 times 8 is 24, so 60 and 24 is 84. And let's just check my notes here. That's exactly the same I got in my notes when I was writing it out. So there you go. There's our first example dealing with joint variation. Let's get to the second one. Bam! Our third example is, again, joint variation. It's just going to be a touch harder because I'm bringing in this idea of the cube root of y. It's just not going to be all exponents of 1. And before I start this example, the previous one where we set up the work to find out what the constant was and then took that extra step of actually writing the joint variation equation out, I feel that's important to see, you know, the actual equation that you have for the problem and then using it to finish the question up. Some textbooks will show the previous example I just worked out by setting up two equal ratios and doing a cross multiplication process. It's of course going to be correct, maybe just a tiny, tiny bit quicker than how I did it. I personally feel like it's important that you can see the, you know, that actual joint variation equation before you actually use it to finish the problem up. So it's just a style of teaching. Some of your books might show the work the same as I did. Some might have done cross multiplication. If z varies jointly as x and the cube root of y, blah, 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 blah. I'm not going to even look at the numbers because that first part of the sentence here has shown me how to set up, or is telling me how to set up the problem. Z varies, so now it's labeled, the way it's worded, you know, if it said y varies directly or jointly or whatever, it would be y equals, but it's z varies jointly or, you know, combined with or inversely or whatever. So they're telling me that z is by itself. And it varies jointly, which is again sort of this extended direct variation setup here. So z varies, so it's going to be k, and it varies jointly as x, so it's going to be k times x, and the cube root of y. So that's going to be the basic structure of our problem. Now this is joint variation, and my last example was joint variation, and I just gave you a little bit, I introduced that little bit of a twist here with the problem, so I'm going to pause and see if you can't work out the problem, and I'll just come back in a few seconds with the solution. You should be able to do this now after seeing the previous example. Just this little extra difficulty with the cube root and the fact that I threw in another fraction that you'll have to deal with. But take a second and see if you can't work these this particular problem on your own. I hope this is what you got. I plugged in again with that first part of the problem where they said what z, x, and y was. I plugged all those values in and found out what my constant value, my constant variation was. Wrote up my joint variation formula. And then went on to the rest of the problem where they said find z when x equals 9 and y equals 27 over 8. And worked out the rest of the problem and got a final answer of 189 over 2. Let's get to that next example. It'll be a combined variation problem. And then the last one will be a word problem. Example number 3. Says f varies directly as g and inversely as h. F varies, f is, something's going on with f and it's equal to a bunch of other stuff going on, so f equals, it varies directly as g, so it's going to be, you know, basically like g times k, that's direct variation, right? F equals another variable times a constant, y equals kx. And inversely is h. Well, inverse variation is y equals k over x. So again, that inverse variation, you're going to find that in the denominator. So inversely is h means that we have f is equal to, I'll start to write an f there again. F is equal to, it varies directly with g and inversely with h. So this is the structure of the equation we're going to do for the rest of the problem. Find g when, so this is the part of the sentence where you're being told what you need to find. So that's not the part of the problem that is going to tell us how to find or give us enough information to find out what k is. This will though. If g is equal to 54 when h is equal to 2 and f is equal to 9, so they're giving us g and h and f, and that means that they're giving us everything except for the constant. So this part of the question again is where we need to start our work. So f is equal to 9, g is equal to 54, times our constant of change over h, which is equal to 2. So we have, let's see here, we have 54 divided by 2 is 27, so we have 9 equals 27k. We need to move that 27 away from the k, they're touching, that means multiplication. So we're going to divide both sides by 27. And last time I checked, 9 over 27 reduced to 1/3. So here is our constant of change. That means we're ready to write the equation out. So bring this up. We get f is equal to g times, or over h, times our constant. Now, I'm going to rewrite this initial equation as instead of g times k over h, let's let that k be over 1 and pull it off to the side and write it as g over h times k, right? If I write this k as k over 1 and multiply my two fractions, I'd have g times k, which is gk, over h times 1, which would be, you know, h. So this is good. This is a different way of looking at the same equation. I'm just pulling the numerator off, and the reason why is because I don't want to have a fraction of 1/3 in my numerator. I don't want to build up a complex fraction if I don't need to. So that k I'm going to pull off to the side as k over 1 or just k, and these are equivalent expressions. So when I take that value of k and plug it in, I get f is equal to basically 1/3 as my value of k times g over, pretty ugly g, there we go, g over h. So f is equal to 1/3 times g over h. Let's go to the part of the problem where we have to actually find out what g is. Find g when f is equal to 3, so we have 3 equals, h is equal to 4, and h is in our denominator, so we have f, which is 3, equals 1/3, times g, but that's what we're looking for, so g over h, and find g when f is 3 and h is equal to 4. Okay, so we have 3, let's go ahead and multiply this together. 1 times g is g, 3 times 4 is equal to 12, and we're trying to solve for g. Well, g has a division of 12 with it, we're going to undo that division by multiplying. And here, the multiplication of 12 and division of 12 cancel out, and we get g is equal to 3 times 10 is 30, 3 times 2 is 6, so 36. Bam! All right, that's our first, combined variation problem. We got one more, it's going to be set up as a word problem, but the work itself is not going to actually look any different. Thank you for watching, by the way. The stretch in a wire under a given tension varies directly as the length and inversely as the square of its diameter. Stop reading and write out the equation. What do we have here? We have the stretch in a wire. So the stretch under a given tension varies directly, so that's going to be y equals kx, so it's going to be some kind of multiplication or the direct variation is found in the numerator, varies directly as the length. Okie dokie. And inversely as the square of the diameter. And then somewhere in there, we need a constant of multiplication. So this is going to be the structure of our combined variation problem. The stretch in a wire under a given tension varies directly as the length and inversely as the square of its diameter. A wire having a length of 5 meters and a diameter of 1.7 millimeters stretches 2.4 millimeters if a second wire made of the same material has a length of 7 millimeters and a diameter of 1.5 millimeters, how much will it stretch? Well, again, even though it's a fancier looking word problem, they need to give us enough information to find the constant of change. So that's going to be here. We have a length of 5 and a diameter of 1.7. And if, with those conditions, it stretches 2.4 millimeters. So we have stretch of 2.4 is equal to the length of 5 and a diameter of 1.7, and we're going to then finish that equation and solve for k. And though I try and do some stuff in my head, I don't think you want to watch me do division and multiplication with decimals. So, with that being said, right off the top of my head, oh, forgot the square there. We have 2.4 equal to 5 divided by 1.7 squared is 1.73 times k. Divide both sides by 1.73, and you get k. Your constant of change is equal to, rounded off value, of course, approximately 1.39. So now that we've got that, we can write our final, or actual equation, which is stretch is equal to length over diameter squared. Times our constant, oops, which is 1.39 now. Okay, so the rest of the problem says, if a second wire made of the same material has a length of 7, okay, so the length here is 7, a diameter of 1.5, how long is it going to stretch? Well, our constant here, we have the length of 7, we have a diameter of 1.5 millimeters, that's going to be squared, and that times 1.39 is going to give us a stretch that is equal to 6.49 millimeters. And that is the end of our discussion of joint and combined variation. I'm Mr. Tarrou. Go do your homework.